Welcome to the test cell, everybody. This is the 66th time that I'm going to try to answer your questions. I'm going to try. Let's get started. The first question is by Peter Campbell. Nice normal name. Nice normal username, I should say. So my question is, why are the majority of gas turbines you work with modified turbojets? Modified turbojets. Yes. This is an LM1500, which is a design which is modified from the J79 design. We did not modify the actual engine. Okay. Do they use modified turbofans in industry as well? Or is there some reason that turbojets are preferred? Thank you. It's a very good question, Peter. We're going to have to go to the blackboard. But before we go to the blackboard, let's take a look at this. This is a modified design of a J79 engine. What's missing? Well, there's kind of two things missing. One of them is all the external aircraft related hardware, pumps, regulators, generators, all that stuff is gone. Another thing is missing is the jet propulsion nozzle that accelerates the exhaust gases to make a forceful jet of gases to push the airplane forward. And we've discussed this before, that the acceleration is caused by, or the force is caused by the acceleration of the gases, not the pressure of the gases. Okay, so it's important to remember that this thing is minus the jet propulsion nozzle. So that makes it a gas generator. It's a gas generator. It generates a high pressure, high temperature stream of exhaust gases. The jet propulsion nozzle reduces that pressure by increasing the velocity and therefore causing thrust. But this is technically not a jet engine, it's a gas generator. So, let's go to the blackboard. Well, Peter, you open up a large can of worms by using the word modified, because I'll try to do this quickly. My quick little diagrams. A turbojet is a compressor, a shaft, turbines, and a propelling nozzle. It's a turbojet. I've drawn one with this space here for an afterburner. That's very simplified. And a gas generator, I'll just put up here, is the compressor, the shaft, the turbines, and no propelling nozzle. All right, so this has been modified. It's a modified turbojet. The propelling nozzle has been removed. Small modification in principle. It's a pretty major part. It's very important. And there you go. So what's a turbofan? Well, the LM2500 is very similar to the LM1500. It comes from the next generation engine. But here's the core of a turbofan. Compressor, shaft, turbines, more turbines, another shaft through the middle, big old fan. Let's make it a single stage fan. And the cowling would be something like that. Okay, so let's modify this turbofan. Actually, it would have a small propelling nozzle right there, although most of the thrust is by the bypass air, as you all know. So we're going to modify this. We're going to take off the jet nozzle. And we're going to, there's the compressor again, the shaft, turbine, and no propelling nozzle. So what we're also going to do is we're going to remove the fan and the central shaft that's powered by the low pressure turbine. We remove all that. So this is a modified turbofan. And because of the magic of the word modified, you'll notice that this and that are the exact same thing. Exactly the same. There was even a turbofan version of the J79 called the CJ805-23. You can look it up. It was an aft fan, but it still had an extra turbine. So there's a gas generator for industrial purposes. There's a gas generator for industrial purposes. And they're the same thing because the stuff they don't need has been stripped away. A turbofan is essentially a turbojet that has had a power turbine and a fan added to it. So you just take that off and you have a turbojet again. You take off the nozzle, you have a gas generator. The core of all gas turbine engines, the basis, the building block, the foundation is a gas generator. It's to compress air, mix it with fuel and burn it, pass it through the turbines, and the resultant exhaust flow has a great deal of energy. That can be used as a jet engine, can be accelerated with a nozzle, or it can be fed to a power turbine, which, let's just draw that in a different color, in blue. An industrial gas generator is connected to with either a short or a long duct, it doesn't matter, there's nothing there, and it's connected to a turbine of 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, depending on the design stages, and that produces mechanical power, and typically your exhaust would be vented up like that. I didn't mean to put this little restriction there. It should be straight, or actually widening. There's no thrust in the power turbine exhaust. There you go. That is an industrial power system. This shaft then does whatever you want it to do. In a helicopter, this turns the helicopter gearbox. In a ship, this turns a gearbox that runs the propeller, like the race boats. Or it can turn an electrical generator, or it can run a pump, like in a natural gas compressor station, or a water pump in certain flood control applications. There you go. So yes, a modified turbofan can be used in industry, and a modified turbojet is used in industry. They both produce a gas generator. I'm thinking maybe you were meaning that is a turbofan engine configuration used in industry. No. No. So you take a turbofan and modify it to become a gas generator, just like you do with a turbojet. There's more modifications because essentially a turbofan is a turbojet with stuff added on that you need to take off. That was a really good question. I hope that helps to answer it. It's a very common theme of questioning that we'll probably revisit over and over again. Okay, and good thing we're here talking about industrial gas generators, because the next question is from Martin. And Martin says, why is the air inlet bell shaped on static engines? Because airliners don't have them. Well, let's just go take a look right now, right over there. Let's go. Well, it's never good to have a white thing on a white background, but here's the bell mouth. You can see it's kind of trumpet shaped. It's got a flare on it. The reason they don't have these on airplanes is because of the incredible drag increase it would cause. Also, it's not necessary because we're going to go back to the blackboard now and explain why this is necessary under static conditions and not while the aircraft is moving. So why is the bell mouth shaped like a bell mouth? Well, let's go, the front of the engine is here, rear, let's go rear, front, just for orientation. The air is going in like this to the engine. There's a low pressure area here, and air is moving into the low pressure area. The stuff from the side, air is going from here. It's coming from all directions. And let's say this air here, let's see if we can draw it in a different color. Let's make the air blue. Okay, it's coming up. It's got to make this really sharp corner to get in there. And it loses velocity whipping around that sharp corner. So what we have is ambient air pressure, we have inlet air pressure, and then we have compressor discharge, which, CDP. So when this engine is running, you're going to have a slight amount of suction here, or lower pressure. I don't like that word suction, but we'll get to that at a later date. the air pressure is lower here than it is ambient. And that is called inlet air depression. Okay, this is in a stationary engine. So let's have a moving engine. And let's make the air blue. So now the aircraft, it's on an aircraft. The air is all coming at it like this. It's going straight at the engine, and some of it goes in and some of it doesn't. Let's say this aircraft is moving at 800 kilometers per hour. Okay, so now the inlet pressure is equal to atmospheric. And that is called ram recovery, because the air is rammed into the engine. As a matter of fact, most engine inlets have a shape something like that, just slightly. And so the air pressure here is higher than it is there. That is called ram recovery of compressor inlet pressure. Okay. Ram air, if you want to call it that. And it really starts to happen after a couple hundred miles an hour. And so that's ram recovery of inlet air pressure. What we try to do is limit the inlet depression on a stationary engine by guiding the air in a smooth transition from perpendicular to parallel flow. And this drastically reduces the losses due to the air having to turn that sharp corner. That's why it's bell mouth shaped, and that's the reason. There's two reasons there's not those things on aircraft. Because one, the effective frontal area of the engine is more than doubled, so the frictional losses or the drag would be huge. But also because of ram recovery, it's not necessary. It's completely unnecessary on a moving aircraft. That's your answer, Martin, and I hope it helps. That is exactly why the bell mouth is shaped like a bell. Oh, and we've got a long question from Spocky Tech. He says, I've been pretty close to the Thunder Down Under jet truck many years ago, so I do have an idea of what they sound like up close. Excellent. Interestingly, as I watched a later run from the stands, the guy next to me was wincing as they were revving the jet and rocking the truck from the torque reaction. I asked him what his problem was, and he said that jet engines don't respond rev-wise that fast, and that what they were actually doing was somehow deliberately creating and clearing a compressor stall, a bit like putting your hand over the inlet to a vacuum cleaner, letting it wind up, and then taking it off. None of that's true. That's all completely, throw it away. None of that makes any sense whatsoever. I'll explain to you in a second. Let's explain it now. What they were doing, what all jet dragsters do and jet trucks, it's not permissible for civilian people like you and me to have afterburner technology, variable nozzles, supersonic engines, that kind of thing. The world's militaries, particularly the world's largest military, doesn't like that. And so that can't happen. You don't get afterburners. You don't get variable nozzles. What the jet trucks and the jet dragsters do is they make their own afterburner nozzle. It's the variable nozzle which allows the airplane to effectively fly at supersonic speeds, so you can't have one. So typically, as I've described before, and I think we'll retire this question here, as we've shown, the afterburner nozzle changes shape depending on whether you're in AB or not. So the jet dragsters want as much thrust as possible. So they tune the nozzle in the open position for afterburner operation. So when they hit the afterburner fuel pumps, they dump all that fuel in the exhaust and they burn it. They get a massive amount of push and the car goes screaming down the track, or the truck. The afterburner nozzle in the open position If the engine is not in afterburning mode, it's in full military power but non-afterburning, it'll make almost no thrust because the nozzle is not set to accelerate that amount of gas. It needs to be closed. And so, even at 100% RPM and full fuel flow without afterburner, the jet dragster can't even move on the ground. So what you're seeing is the driver blips the afterburner, and it sounds like a bomb or a it's very loud. It sounds like a rocket. There's only thrust produced by the engine when it's in afterburner, because you get your choice when you make a fixed nozzle. You can fix it in this shape or in that shape. It's not movable. So that's why the jet truck sits there. Then you see a huge flame and a lot of noise, and it moves forward. Usually the guy's on the brakes as well. He's got the brakes on. He wants to move forward a foot. So he hits the afterburner, rocks forward a bit, hits it again until he just inches up to the line. There's no way to make any power with that engine unless the afterburner's on because of the fixed nozzle. It's not a compressor stall. It's not a vacuum cleaner. It's not your hand over a vacuum cleaner. It's not even a difference in revolutions per minute for the engine. The engine speed is exactly the same in and out of afterburner. The afterburner can only be engaged at 100%. So there you go. I have answered this question a few times. And now we go back to the story. He explained that given that the engine was some surplus, heavily used XB-52 engine, that repeatedly creating compressor stalls would be flexing the turbine blades a lot. Well, first of all, the compressor and a turbine, they're different parts. You do a compressor stall, and all that does is lower the amount of gases going through the turbine and actually increase their temperature. It doesn't flex the turbine blades at all. We're mixing up turbine blades and compressor blades again, and you know that is one of my pet peeves. The two parts are at opposite ends of the engine. The compressor moves air. The turbine is moved by air. They are the exact opposite thing. Exact opposite thing. Okay. Flex the turbine blades a lot and potentially causing the old, possibly cracked blades to explosively exit the side of the engine, and they really shouldn't be doing that. Blah, blah, blah. None of that's accurate. He was telling you garbage. Floofily, boobly garbage. He didn't make any sense whatsoever. The company that built the truck was, like yourself, a turbine refurb company, and they should know better. They do know better. They know better not to worry about people's worrying about stuff that makes no sense because of what they believe is based on incorrect misunderstandings of what's really going on. What do you think? Are repeated deliberate compressor stalls on an old engine dangerous? They're dangerous on any engine, and they're never done. Nobody ever does deliberate repeated compressor stalls. That is not what you were watching. Okay, I'm going to move on now because I don't want to get. Okay, good question by Spocky Tech. Not to worry, that was the afterburner system being used in a jet truck. And keep in mind that these things were never designed, ever, ever, ever designed to be put in a car. Never. So it's the fact that it's not designed for a car, and the fact that variable jet propulsion nozzles are not available to the public, those two things combined causes that unique set of operational procedures to be used by jet dragsters and jet trucks. Okay, super cool. And now from Richard Evans. I've seen a number of videos of aircraft engineers working on airframes and jet engines, and none appear to use electric drills tools to loosen tighten screws or assemble disassemble parts. They always use mechanical tools, which seem less effective time-wise. If I'm right, why is this? You're mostly right, I think so. Because you talk about being less efficient time-wise. What's the most important thing? What's the most important thing to you? Did I build your jet engine fast, or did I build it right? You're flying over the Pacific Ocean, 1,000 miles from anything, 5 miles in the air, at 600 miles an hour. Metric conversions apply. Now,
Do you want to know that it took 6 weeks to build that engine, or that it's 100% correct? What's more important? It could have taken 6 months, but it's perfect. Might have taken 3 weeks, and we mostly got it right. What's the most important thing to you? So, power tools allow you to wreck things very quickly. Anybody who's ever witnessed somebody else, of course you've never done it yourself, you take a drill driver with a Phillips bit on it, put it in a Phillips screw, and it skips as it's driving the screw in. That screw's ruined. And so if you can't drive a screw without skipping, you'll never get that one screw in, because if you skip it, it's got to come out, throw it away, put another one in. Oh, and by the way, each screw is worth $60 or whatever. I remember there were studs I was replacing in an Avon turbine case. There was over 80. Actually, I think there were 72 of them, and each one of them was 60 English pounds each. So you don't want to wreck stuff. Plus, it's often more time efficient to go slowly and do it right than to ram ahead, wreck stuff, and have to back up and fix it. So that's why power tools are generally not used. Disassembly, yes. Oftentimes air tools or electric tools might be used to undo the myriad bolts in the compressor cases. Not a problem. But generally on final assembly, you want to try to go slow and smooth. Don't damage the parts, and put it together well, as it should. It should go together like a Swiss watch. Okay? So that is why. Where are we now? That's why, Richard Evans, that hand tools are preferred over power tools, particularly on the final assembly of delicate things like jet engines, that need to be as close to perfect as is humanly possible. And really, it always matters, production always matters, but the speed of production of aerospace parts is not the most important thing to consider. It's quality and accuracy and correctness. Yeah. Our last question today is going to require two cameras, that one, and one we'll pick up in a second. It's by, there's no name. Well, I apologize to the person who sent this question in, but you'll recognize it. I didn't put your name in here. Feel free to comment below that it was you. Okay, here we go. In a previous video, when you were discussing the inner workings of a Rolls-Royce Allison T56 501 turboprop, you stated that as the compressed air exits the compressor section, then passes through the diffuser, mid-frame, it will then enter the engine's combustion section. Yes. You explained how some of the compressed air will enter each of the six combustion chambers near the fuel nozzle end of the chamber. Well, that would be the Arenda. There's an Arenda compressor right there. There's Arenda combustors right there. Hang on, right there. All rusty and ugly, but you're going to take a look at them right now. Right there. Those are the six, and they are indeed retired. Retired. Okay, back to normal. Compressed air will enter each of the six combustion chambers near the fuel nozzle end of the chamber. Then you went on to state that some of the remaining air will enter the same combustion chambers as it passes over the outside of the chamber to dilute the flame. The outside of the liner. You're mixing up liner with chamber. We'll show you that in a second too. Outside of the liner to dilute the flame, etc., as the air moves aft toward the turbine section. My question is, will all of the air introduced into the midsection combustion area exit into the turbine section only through the combustion chambers? Or worded differently, can some of the air enter the turbine section without having to pass through one of the six combustion chambers? No. That's an easier question than I thought it was going to be, because I thought you meant, can some of the air that goes around the liner inside the chamber get into the turbine nozzle without going inside the liner? That's also no. Let me set up the camera in a different location and we'll discuss this. All right, here's a rusty old combustion chamber. By combustion chamber, I mean the outer case. All the air goes through here. This is sealed with a big O-ring. So all of the air from the compressor goes in there. Some of it goes in there. That's to help burn the fuel. And this outer area is where most of the air goes. And that's around the outside of the liner. We've got a liner separate in here. Hang on. We just happen to have a liner. This is a liner from the same combustor can. Fits in there. Okay. So all of the air that comes in through here, there's a steel case on the outside and it leaks in through these slots and holes and deals and stuff. Comes out there. This right here is sealed to the to here. It's sealed. There's a tiny gap there, like a quarter inch gap. And I guess some air does leak around there and go into the turbine nozzles to cool the nozzles in this engine. Let's take a look at another engine, which is different, which is actually right behind me. This is from a J79/LM1500. I want to show you something.
Okay, the J79, there's a somewhat built one. The combustor outer liner is here. It's a solid steel, a sheet steel case. There's no leaks anywhere. That's a hole for an igniter. But it's a barrier to air passage. It's all solid, completely steel. And it's around this bunch of combustors. So these are the 10 liners that make up the combustion section. And so that sheet steel casing is around here. All the air is leaking in through these holes and these louvers, which show up better there. Okay. And that case is around this whole thing and it's sealed right there. So all of the air that's in this, where my hand is, all of the air has to go through these holes. It stops here. So no air can bleed into the turbine air that's coming out of the nozzles. I hope that answers your question. All of the air that comes out of the compressor goes through the combustion system. It doesn't squeak by. And it comes out as hot but not fiery gases that go through the nozzles to the turbine. A very interesting question. With a lot of rusty parts. Okay, we're out here in front of the shop on a bright sunny day with the cutaway. This just returned from the Fort St. John Air Show. And it's got a interesting feature. We're looking at this is where the cooling air would be. And it leaks in through those holes into where the flame would be here. This hole here is for a temperature probe that was for research, so it wouldn't be there. But the only air that can leak by the combustion section without going into the gas path would be through that tiny little gap there. And it would then end right there. That's the neighbor's kids playing. That's what they do. Kids play. That stops all of it, and so that little bit of air that comes through this gap would leak down into the air-cooled first stage nozzles right there that guide the air to the first stage of the turbine. So in this particular engine, some of the air does bypass the combustors. This would be compressor discharge air coming out of the compressor, which is there, going through the midframe, staying outside the combustor liners, squeaking through that gap right there, and finally traveling inward into the first stage nozzles. So there you go. In this particular engine, There is some air that gets past the combustor section without joining in with the working air. This is our little spiel. It doesn't mention that there are many different marks of the J79. Dash 1, 3, 5, 8, 10, 11, 15, 17, and 19 that I know of. And then there's the CJ805 and the LM1500. All basically the same thing, with minor differences and improvements as the manufacturing proceeds through the years. Super cool.
From the indoor-outdoor covered storage area on a beautiful summer day, amidst a forest of power. I wonder how many engines we have in here. Thanks for watching.